Jesus, Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth about the honors of thy name. So come on.
Good morning, everyone. And welcome back to another version of our Abundant Life Church, Sunday morning virtual home church. So glad to have everyone who is here in attendance working this morning, and everyone out there in our virtual interwebs. If you would please join us in worshiping this morning as we kick it back with a little bit of old school. Yeah. Savior forever. He shot me and he pardoned me with his redeeming love. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is through him. He brings me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. And I heard about the healing of his cleansing power. To walk again, cause the blind to see. And then I cried to Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. All my love is to him. He plumps me to victory. Beneath the cleansing. Oh, victory. To me in Jesus, my Savior forever. He shot me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him. All my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Come on, play it out. All y'all at home, get that air guitar going. About a mansion that he has built for me in glory. And I heard about those streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing that old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory.
My Savior forever. He shot me and he bought me with his redeeming blood.
He loved me and,
he loved me and I knew him. And all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory
beneath the cleansing blood. Oh, victory, victory in Jesus.
My Savior forever. He shot me and he bought me with his redeeming blood.
And he loved me and I knew him.
And all my love is to him. He plunged me into victory
beneath the cleansing blood. He plunged me to victory. Sometimes you're just playing so hard you drop a pick. Come on, keep worshiping with us. Singing to the King. Right. the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever see. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Lord, we live for you. Just the name of every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever see. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Lord, we live for you. Holy. A firm foundation. I will put my trust in you, and I will not be ashamed.
I will build my life upon your love.
open up my eyes.
Show me who you are.
Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me
in your outer doors. Only there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Right wherever you are this morning, can you just lift your hands towards heaven for just a moment and just begin to magnify the King today? Come on, just lift your hands. Begin to magnify Him and love on Him for just a moment. Take just a moment in your own way just to begin to let the Lord know that you're here for Him, that you love Him, that you worship Him. Come on, let's move beyond this relaxed atmosphere for a moment. Let's just begin to press in for a moment. Lord, we just worship You today, God. We thank You. Lord, let us not get lax in our worship. Let us not get lax in our dedication toward You. God, let us stand in adoration and praise unto You, God. Let us lift up holy hands and magnify You for a moment, God. Let us just lift up our voice and begin to declare You today in the name of Jesus. Begin to speak Your needs out. Speak them out right where you are. Wherever it is that you're watching this morning, begin to speak your needs out to the Lord and just begin to confess them to Him right now. Come on, just speak them out. Speak them out in the name of Jesus this morning. Speak them out in the name of Jesus. Speak them out. Speak them out to the Lord this morning. He hears you. Hallelujah, Lord. One more time, sing holy.
Holy, there is no one like You. There is none beside You. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who You are and fill me with Your heart.
Touch this morning. Just right where you are, just put your hands together and love on Jesus. Amen. Let's magnify Him for a moment this morning. Amen. Give Him glory and honor and praise and adoration. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You're standing. You may be seated. Take just a moment. I want you to worship with me in giving this morning. Worship with me in giving. I have a very untheological scripture to share with you in reference to giving this morning. One that is not normally used in this particular context, but I believe it speaks to us in so many ways. Colossians chapter 3, beginning in verse 23. It says these words in the literal translation: whatever you do, do it enthusiastically as something that is done for the Lord and not for men. I'm going to say that one more time. Whatever you do, do it enthusiastically as something that is done for the Lord and not for man. When we give this morning, let's do that with a cheerful heart, with a loving heart, and with an enthusiastic heart. Let's be enthused, as it were. Let's use that word today. To put smiles upon our face and joy in our hearts as we give. And when we give to Him, we give to Him with a cheerful heart because God loves a cheerful giver. So at the conclusion of this prayer this morning, there'll be four ways that'll come up on the screen that you can bless the Lord. It's important that we continue to honor God even through this process, because I promise you it won't be too much longer. We'll have the opportunity for us to come back together into the sanctuary and worship again. But until that time, we've got to continue to maintain. Somebody say maintain. We've got to maintain. Or one translation, King James, says we've got to continue to contend. So we need to continue to contend and stay fast before the Lord. Amen. Let us pray together. Take what's in your hand today and hold it up towards heaven. And let's ask God's blessings today. Our Father, we love you today. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy and your love. We thank you for the opportunity to give. And we thank you, God, that as we honor you, you are honoring us by taking care of our needs according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. We stand upon your word enthusiastically this morning as a cheerful giver, ready and prepared to give to you. We declare this now in Jesus' name. All God's children say it with me. Amen. Bring your gifts. Today. Amen. I want you to find yourselves in the Word this morning in Luke, the sixth chapter. Luke chapter 6. We're going to read just a few verses of Scripture this morning, beginning in verse 45. Luke chapter 6 and verse 45. And again, if I missed it a moment ago, I wanted to say good morning to you. So excited to see all of you. Even though you can see more of me than perhaps I can see you. But the fact of the matter is though we are separated this morning, we are separated together. And so we are already in the works of planning our next drive-in church prior to the reopening of the church. And so there is a conference call in reference to all of that going tomorrow evening, in which case I will be on, so that way we can pull all of that together and figure out with our leadership team what we need to do moving forward. But we want to thank you for your dedication and your faithfulness unto the Lord. Let's get down to the meat of the word this morning. I want you to go with me there to Luke chapter 6, beginning with verse 45. When you're there, just look at the screen and say, Pastor, amen. Here's what the word says. A good man, out of the good measure of his heart, bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man, out of the evil treasure of his heart, bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaketh. Verse 46. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whosoever cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built a house, has dug deep, and laid the foundation of a rock. When the flood arose and the stream beat vehemently upon the house, he could not shake it, for it was founded upon the rock. But he that heareth and doeth it not, it was like a man that is built with a foundation upon the house of the earth, and against which the stream did not beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of the house was great. In short, literal translation says it like this: a man that builds a house after digging deep, laying a firm foundation on rock, when a flood rose and the storm came, the house stood and shook not. But when the house is built upon the earth and the sand thereof, it shifts. And when the storm comes and beats upon it, it falls down flat immediately and goes to ruin. This morning, I want to minister with the help of the Holy Spirit in your prayer upon this thought today. Two words: unshakable foundation. An unshakable foundation. Father, we love you. Come on, stretch your hands this way and ask the Lord to touch me today. Father, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity to share your word, to love you beyond measure, to reach out to you, God, knowing that you're going to reach within our hearts and our minds right where we are this morning. Father, I pray our next few moments together, you'll anoint this vessel of clay to deliver your word your way. I pray that no other barrier, nothing physical, spiritual, or even financial will get in the way of your word going forth today. And Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that it will not return you void, but fill every void in every life today. God, go forth by your word today. Speak to our hearts. Direct us. Direct our minds in the name of Jesus today, and God will give you the praise. Amen, amen, and amen. You may be seated if you can this morning. Now, Jesus here is speaking to two men during a building process and kind of leads up to where he's headed as it pertains to the foundation in which that they are to build upon. Now, we know this is metaphorically in so many ways, but when you look at this, you actually see that in his parable that he's sharing some true facts. A true fact is, if you're going to build something to last, it needs to be built upon a strong foundation that no matter what comes by its way, it cannot be shaken. It needs to be an unshakable foundation. That's so that it will not move or shift when it encounters an adversity that comes its direction. So now we look at the first man, and we're going to call him number one. So first man, number one, in this parable has built a house firmly upon the rock. And upon the rock, when the storms came and the wind came and beat upon the structure, the house stood still and in place. And it's important to understand the foundation. So many people look at a foundation like on a brick home, and we'll talk about that in a few moments, about what's been poured. But may I tell you that even in a poured foundation of a brick home, if the underground is not properly prepared, the underground can continue to shift and cause cracks in what's been poured. That's why the Bible says it was important for the man to dig deep. The other man, we'll call him number two. Number two this morning built his house directly upon the earth. No preparation, no plans. Translation begins to tell us that it's sand or dirt, the earth, in which that he built directly upon. And when his home encountered the storms and the winds, the Bible says it went to ruins and fell. Now, the moral of the parable is this. Crumble and shifting foundations will shift with every wind, and eventually crummy foundations will not last. I'm going to say that again. Crumbling and shifting foundations will shift with every wind, and eventually the crummy foundation simply will not last. We need unshakable foundations today. We are living in an uncertain time in which that we need firm foundations that the Lord will build his church upon. Not a man's church, not a denominational church, but his church. He's got to have his church established. Because see, I got news for every Pentecostal. There's going to be some Baptists in heaven. There's going to be some Presbyterians in heaven. There's going to be some Episcopalians in heaven. Hello? I know y'all are going to shoot me for this, and that's okay. There's even going to be some Catholics that are going to make it to heaven. I wish we would stop looking at the flavors of life that we have all labeled ourselves and start recognizing that there is one God that we all need to serve, and his name is Jesus. Can you say amen? When we put him at the forefront of everything that we're doing and we make him number one this morning, the right builder, things will begin to transpire and take place. So let's talk about the right builder this morning. When a person is looking for a home or planning on building a home, they want to know that the builder's reputation is credible. You don't want to just go searching on Facebook under Marketplace and find you a home builder. Because guess what? You might find a very crummy creation. Hello. It's important that when you're looking for something, that you're looking for somebody that's replicable, somebody that has a good reputation, that's credible, and has proven with their track record through the materials and the craftsmanship in which that they use and the way that they work, that they have homes that are still standing. Now, when we look at this, if the home is a mobile home, you need to take a look at the structure of that mobile home. You need to go to a reputable manufactured home builder because they make some beautiful homes. Somebody said amen. Mobile homes are amazing. I mean, and what they can do in those structures are incredible. But may I tell you that if the land that they're going to set it on is not properly prepared, if the person that sets it up is not also credible, meaning they don't know how to properly block it up, or now they even have new set-in foundations that manufactured homes can sit on. And if those are not properly set in place and have not been tempered just right and have not been anchored down to the earth proper and the ground beneath it is not properly prepared, may I tell you, the mobile home might look good for a season, but eventually its underneath is going to begin to shift and waver. Now you look at a pier and beam home, much what was built so many times, especially in the mid to late 70s. So many pier and beam homes were built, and people begin to see those because they seem to be a pretty good structure. And you must make sure, again, that the ground is proper. Because if that under ground of the earth is not properly set right and is not properly prepared right, then it doesn't matter how beautiful the home looks. And there's a lot of real beautiful country homes, and some people call them farm homes because it's a lot what they used to build on the farms, and they were beautiful and they were huge. They were plantation looks. My grandmother used to love it because she'd say, I want one of those houses that's got a porch all the way around it. I can walk all the way around my house and I'll find me a rocking chair at each corner. You know, it's a beautiful thing, you know. And those big, huge plantation style homes are gorgeous. But my friends, if you don't dig deep and prepare the ground and level it off and get it right, guess what? It doesn't matter how beautiful that it looks. Eventually, the ground's going to shift. And when it does, so is that house. In both of these applications, you've got to deal with this thing called leveling. Because as the ground shifts and quakes and moves around, if you don't constantly do maintenance to them and level them out, then guess what? That shifting process can continue to deteriorate and ruin the flooring foundation of your home. And eventually, everything that is beautiful and everything that is wonderful and everything that is lovely begins to start cracking and coming apart. Now we get to the brick home. The brick home has a poured foundation. It's one that one must know that all of the plumbing has been done. Any under electrical that has to be ran is already done and pulled up through the piping. That the piping is set proper. That all of the forms have been done right. But before you do any of that, you got to prepare the lot. The earth has got to be prepared. It may cause you to have to bring in some kind of an earth mover. It may be as small as a bobcat, and it may be as big as one of those that goes through and retrenches dirt roads on a country area. But may I tell you, you've got to come in there and you've got to scrape it down to where it gets down into the solid leveled area of the ground so that when you put your forms down and you put your rebar in and you put your mesh in and you line up all the areas and you make sure that you're not going to encounter any other elements that's going to get inside of the pore of your foundation and begin to ruin your house from the ground up. Oh, I feel the Lord this morning. May I tell you, it's imperative that you make sure that the ground is prepared even before you start setting the forms, way before you ever get to the plumbing. But watch this. If you miss a step in the process, after you have poured that concrete, you've got no other choice but to take your jackhammer and jack up every last thing that is messed up underneath there, every last thing you forgot, every last element that you left out, because if not, you'll find out that it's going to mess you up later. And if that's not enough for you, when you're pouring a foundation, you need to also check the elements of the outdoors. You need to make sure the temperature is right. Because if the concrete gets too cold or if it gets too hot, when it pours, it will not set proper. In addition to that, you need to know that when it is poured and set in place, you got to make sure the next few days are going to be good days for the temperature for that to absolutely form itself in such a way that it sets right. Get too much water in something, it becomes soupy. Come on. Get too much sunlight in something, it gets hard too fast. It's got to be the right set of elements so that way when you pour the foundation, it stands. There's so many factors that go into this. But the one thing about a brick home, unlike the pier and beam home and unlike the mobile home, where you can jack it up and you can re-level and you can re-block and you can refix, that when the foundation pour of that home begins to be shifted and it cracks and breaks, you have to go into the foundation of the ground and virtually start all over. I've had friends of mine that have had issues with a home where they actually had to drill and cut out areas of their flooring inside of their home in many different areas to go back in there and refix the structure up underneath their homes because of this situation. You don't get to just bring a jack out and a leveling team and a few blocks and jack it up and refix it and level out the structure or put a few more blocking areas up underneath it. No, there's so much more that goes to it because, see, once you've poured that brick foundation, once you've poured that concrete down into the ground, it's now final. The only way to change its final situation is to break it all up and start all over again. Spiritually, when we look at the application here, spiritually, we look at this and we see so many people that are building their lives on shifting ground. It's easy to do because the attraction of what it looks like from the beginning is wonderful. But they built their relationships upon sand. And they continue to lack firm foundation because the earth is continually moving and shifting. Not deep preparation, because deep-rooted preparation will not let you be wavering and will not let you be blown here and blown there and tossed here and tossed there. It causes you to want to put down a solid foundation and stay put. People wonder why it is that they're constantly having family problems. They wonder why their children don't obey anymore. And it's not just when they become adults and 18 years old and think they got everything figured out. You're starting to see those issues popping up and creeping up in 7 to 10-year-olds and moving itself forward. People are scared to death to correct the child today. Why? Because society says that's not the way we do it. Yet the word of the Lord says when you spare a rod, you spoil a child. Sometimes children are older, and when you have to correct them, they don't like it. Or they wonder why it is that their finances are so overwhelming. Now, overwhelming is a good word, because guess what? Somebody that gets too much money too fast and lacks in wisdom, doesn't exercise good wisdom in how to manage and take care of said finance. It's sometimes worse than somebody that's lacking in finances and trying to manage in life. It's still overwhelming, just in another way. The church needs to be looking for these kinds of people today. What? What did you say, Pastor? I said, we need to be looking for these folks. We need to help connect them to the right builder. We need to help connect them to the right solution. We need to start correcting them and leading them in the direction of Jesus. People already know all their faults. They know their problems. And so what is the point of wasting time talking about those? Just answer me. What is the point? You at home that are watching this morning, what's the point? What's the point of pointing out someone else's faults and issues and problems and waste that time? Why don't we focus upon a solution? Nobody wants to talk about solutions. They want to talk about problems. You know why they don't want to talk about solutions? Because they don't want to be a part of it. Hello? If you want to be a part of a solution, then that means you put yourself in a place where you're usable, not in a seat of judgment. The church is not here to judge. I was talking to somebody just prior to service this morning. Had a wonderful conversation. Loved it. And I said, remember this. Called him by name. Called him brother. And I said to him, you don't have to worry about sitting in a seat of judgment. That's not our call. But don't forget that through a spirit of discernment, God's called you to be a good fruit checker. So don't susceptibility yourself to situations that will cause your fruit to become ill, or cause your fruit tree to become sick, or you get a spiritual disease on you that you don't need to be dabbling or dealing with. Come on, somebody. I feel the Lord this morning. I believe I've got a word for you today. See, if we get to the place now to where we offer a point of direction, then we'll direct them to the right builder that will help them to dig deep, level the ground. And when they pour that foundation, or when they block up that structure, they won't have to worry even when the elements of life come. Because it doesn't matter what the devil or the world comes up with the storms of life, and they're going to come. But the fact
fact of the matter is when we call upon the name of the Lord while he is yet near, and we do what the songwriter says, and we declare that Jesus is the center of it all, then we get to the places, I will build my life, come on somebody, on things above and not things beneath. I am the head and not the tail. I am above and not beneath. I am greater than he that is in me than he that is in the world. Start putting the word down inside and let the word come alive, because it's our foundation. Hallelujah. We need to offer solutions instead of opinions. We need to lead by example and lead them to Jesus and let the Holy Spirit do his work to reaffirm them in their foundation. Turn around to your neighbor and say, we need unshakable foundation. Here's some true facts. The floods of sorrow are going to come. The waves of temptation are going to show up. The gales of adversity will rise. But the good news for all of us today is this. A house built by the master craftsman Jesus will stand through it all. Can you just lift your hands wherever you are and begin to magnify him for just a moment and say, Lord, I thank you for my firm foundation. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah, Lord. I thank you, Lord. See, I see Christians and believers, as it were, today more like a pier and beam style home. Although you cannot just attach wheels underneath it to mobilize it and move it, even though there are home movers that can make that happen. It's basically a structure that's to be set in place once the ground is prepared. In church today, we have too many mobile Christians. They never stay put, and they're always moving and shifting with the tides of the things going on around them, and their opinions shift with the next big thing. Then we've got brick-style Christians that, like Jeremiah saw at the potter's house, become untouchable. Don't teach me nothing. Don't touch my area. Don't mess with me. Don't speak that in my name. Don't speak that over me. Untouchable pottery that gets hardened and cannot be touched. You need to remember the story of Jeremiah. When he went down to the potter's house, he went and looked inside, and inside of the house was a beautiful showroom, and he saw the potter at the work, at the wheels, and was working on the pottery because the clay was still very viable in the hands of the potter. But when he looked out over the field, he also saw all of these discarded pots, and he looked at the potter and said, what is it of these? He said, these are the ones that I can't use anymore. They've gotten too hard. They're not touchable. May I tell you, oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. We do not need to get to a place to where we're untouchable, because we are not the foundation. Jesus is the foundation. And he says, come unto me, all these that are burdened and are heavy laden. I will grant you your rest. When you get in the presence of an almighty God, something begins to change. But he needs to be the foundation that you're building on. We got to stop building monuments and houses to ourselves and start building to the King. Brick style structures that are finalized in their ways will deal with shifting ground and will crack to rubble. The pier and beam Christian, though it doesn't seem to be the most settled, doesn't seem the most final, has the most flexibility in the hands of the craftsman. Because if the craftsman decides that the house or the vessel needs to move, he can assemble a team, put things up underneath the house, lift the house, and move the house to where it needs to go. If he's unsettled with the areas in which that are shifting, he can draft a team to jack it up, dig down deep, and reaffirm and level it out. And if if all else fails, even inside, because of the shifting and the moving of the ground, if something is not firmed up, you can always fix the interior structure of a situation, but you've got to affirm the foundation that it sits on, or your paint and your stucco and your glue and your caulking will be of no effect, because it will crack all over again. What we've got to be concerned with in church, in spirituality of our own selves, is how much cracking are we willing to put up with? Churches come apart for one main reason: too many cracks. Hello. Be a vessel. Be a vessel that God can send in His spiritual home builders to. Take a look at the structure of the potential of what He has called upon you to become. Send them in with the right elements to build you and your life better than it ever was before. Firming up your foundation and securing your future, it will cause you to have an unshakable foundation. Somebody said amen. Woo. An unshakable foundation. It's defined as a place and a resettling of the structure where the vessel has been placed. Don't uproot and go somewhere else just because things didn't happen your way. Don't tear up the structure. No longer dealing with the constant leveling issues that will come by your way if you'll simply fix the ground work first. What are you building your life on today? Huh, what a question. We're no longer in life dealing with certainties, but we're dealing with uncertainties every single day. Situations that even God Himself looks upon today and shakes His head, I'm sure. This is, what are they doing? Have you ever wondered that about yourself? Friends at home, have you ever wondered that about yourself? Have you ever asked yourself the question, looked in the mirror and said, what am I doing? Feel like you're beating your head against the wall and you've pounded bricks until your knuckles bleed? Have you ever looked at yourself and asked those questions? Anybody with any maturity whatsoever, you'd be a liar if you said you didn't. Male or female. Should I have done that? Should I have stepped that way? Whatever. But I'm reminded in closing of verse 46. It says, why call Him Lord? If we're not going to make Him the master builder over our lives, then why call Him Lord? Why lie to yourself? Because either Jesus is the master over your life or you are. Well, what about the devil? When you have entrusted things to yourself, you will fall short of the glory of God and end up in diverse temptation. And then the devil wins anyway, and he didn't even have to work. Too many times we blame the devil for stuff we do. For foundations that we don't build by digging deep. Make that decision for Jesus today. Put Him at the center. And let Him become your foundation. That's when you'll call Him Lord. Make Him the new builder that keeps us level, that knows the foundations in the area. If you're going to build in California, you better know you're not building on a fault line. Because if you get anywhere close to that fault line and the earthquake hits, your house is coming down. Better be careful of the groundwork where you've had a house built Because there's sinkholes now that they're finding all over the earth. Quite especially in the United States of America. And people inside their homes and when they're gone and outside their homes are coming back and finding their homes in the middle of a great big ditch. Why? Because it wasn't built on solid ground. What do we look like spiritually to the Lord today? How can He level us? How can He firm up our foundation? It's Jesus that keeps us grounded physically and emotionally. I couldn't even preach to you this morning if I didn't have Him on my side. No spiritual homes are going to be able to stand if Christ is not in the center of them. Call yourself a Christian all you want to, but if Christ is not the center of what you do, you've built on shifting ground and sinking sand. Reaffirming our foundation happens when family prayer happens again. Did you hear me at home? When family prayer happens again. When Bible reading and devotions happen again. When our dedication to the Lord happens again. When our commitment level rises. And when we take an active involvement in our local church. Many of our leadership team have called you. Who have you called? When's the last time you called pastor for no other reason than to simply say, I love you? Hello? I'm not complaining today. I'm asking a question. What's your foundation? What is it that you're built on? These three ingredients create an unshakable foundation with Christ. And He's the hardening agent that keeps it all steady. Parents, grandparents, guardians, church family, hear me. I pray God uses us in the midst of all of this to come back stronger, firmer, and unshakable than we ever have before with our foundation. Because unshakable foundation people can see themselves through every situation as long as Christ is at the head. He's the center and He's the head. A good friend of mine a long time ago pointed out a very good thought to me. Said this, two heads on any one thing is a monster. It's not Jesus and pastor, it's Jesus. Hello. Because I'm following Christ, and I'm hoping that as I'm following Christ and you're following my lead, that you'll follow Christ. Hello. But that's the way we need to roll. That's the way we need to move. That's the way we need to structure. So that way our focus and our attention is upon Him. I pray that we see each pattern of our behaviors. And that whatever we need to do to correct it, to become those that exemplify Christ in everything that we do, is what the corrections is that we need to make. What is it that we need to alter? What is it that we need to work on? We cannot close this message out without asking hard questions today. And here they are. What are we building our spiritual homes upon today? Each one of you are a spiritual house where the Holy Spirit desires to reside. Where the quickening of the Holy Spirit comes to. Where the conviction of the Holy Spirit lays. Come on, somebody. Where the direction of the Holy Spirit speaks. You're a vessel that God wants to feel and touch. What does your foundation really look like? Did you dig deep first? How do I do that? On your knees before God. I've never gotten on my knees before God. Start today. Take a moment out. I'm going to tell you what happens to me when I get down on my knees before God. Eventually I end up on my face, planted into the floor. And I hear him more clearly then than I do any other time. My goodness. What does your foundation really look like today? And the final question to you today is Christ the center of it all? Doesn't matter what your children are or are not doing today. What are you doing? What example are you? What are you doing to mentor people with your life? How are you directing people by your life? Here it is. The short answer is this. We are either building on the center of Christ and His will, or we have built upon the sand of self-will. It's one or the other. We have either built on the center of Christ's will, or we have built on the sand of self-will. That's the answer. I want to pray with you today. And I want to pray for those that are with us this morning. And as I pray for you today, if the Lord is speaking to you in this message today, while I'm praying, I just want you to slip your hand towards heaven and just ask the Lord to touch you. Because there's no distance in prayer. Hear me, if you're at home, you're sitting on your couch, or maybe you're at your dining table and you're watching this, or maybe you can't watch it right now, real time, and you're watching it later on. Hear me. What does your foundation look like? What is your life sitting on? If you look around the inside of the structure spiritually and you see a lot of cracks, you need to go dig deep and check the foundation. And we bow our hearts in prayer this morning. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for your peace and your hope. Thank you, Lord, for your direction, for your call, and for your hand upon our lives. Lord Jesus, if there's one under the sound of my voice this morning, whether they're present as the leadership team or essential team this morning, or whether they're online with us today, let them look in the mirror and ask the questions of themselves. Not just of one another, pointing finger at one another, but of themselves. What does my foundation look like? What does my spiritual home represent? Has it went to ruins? Have I gotten lackadaisical in my approach towards the Lord? Has my self-will overcome His perfect will? Lord, let us ask the questions. And when we ask the questions, Lord, prepare our hearts and our minds for the answer. Let us be settled enough where we are so that we can receive the direction as the Holy Spirit speaks. Lord, they're joining us now or watching us later. Let the peace of God that surpasseth all understanding, settle upon your people. Let the direction of the Holy Spirit speak. Let us hear. While we're sheltering in place and trying to follow the rules the best we can, Lord, help us to overcome those overwhelming moments in time
where it seems like things are just coming apart at the seams. Help us see the picture you see. And if we need re-leveling, Lord, send the crew. If we need reaffirming, send the crew. Whatever it is we need, send them so that we can do it right for you. Your word declares this: I've never seen the righteous forsaken while their seed begging bread. We're not beggars today, God. We're blessed. And we walk in that blessing every day. But let us not walk in that blessing with the attitude that you owe us, because you owe us nothing. But we owe you all. Let us stop the self-will attitude of what's in it for me and what do I get out of it and how it affects me. And let us start realizing that your example said it was how I could affect others and how I could bless others. Send the Holy Spirit to overcome pride, to overcome self-will, and convict us one more time that we are burdened to share your love, to share your gospel message without wavering, standing on the firm foundation of the Word of God. And God will give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Can we clap our hands and bless the Lord? Will you clap with us at home and bless Him today? Hallelujah. Lord, we bless you today and we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. If you need to call the office for anything whatsoever this week, feel free to do that. Food bank will be drive-through food bank on Tuesday. And we look forward to the help of our essential team that assists us with that. They'll begin bringing in groceries tomorrow and bagging all of those up and getting those prepared to hand out. And thanks to that team that continually, week after week, has done this. 4 weeks in a row. I think we're on week number 5 now that we are working together to see this happen. We don't normally do it every week, but we have because of the need. Even the Greater Harvest Food Banks have realized that they have went from something like 60,000 people of helping to over 120,000 people in these last 4 weeks. And food banks are beginning to be stressed because of items not coming in, because items not being provided. Please continue to pray. Please continue to give. Your giving is making a difference in continuing to keep things afloat and keep it going. Finally, I ask for your prayers this week. I will be out of pocket. Sister Deneen and I will be taking a trip, leaving very early in the morning on Tuesday and traveling by vehicle to Georgia and back in the same week. So we covet your prayers and ask for you to continue to watch over us, and we're going to do our best to limit any stops whatsoever along the way so that we can go and we can come right back. Pop Mauser's going to speak this next Sunday morning. We're going to have a wonderful, wonderful time in the Lord. And I'm just looking forward to Jesus continuing to bless. But if you have a need of any kind and I can't handle it over the phone, I want you to call the office and we will dispatch one of our team your direction to reach out to you and help you in any way they can. If you are shut in and you can't get to us for groceries, you call the office tomorrow morning before we begin the drive-thru, because we start at home and work our way out. So if you're a part of home, and for some of you, you need to hear this, if you've been a part of home and you have a need, don't hesitate to call home. And we'll do our best to reach out and take care of that need. God is faithful. And your faithfulness is making the difference. Let us pray in dismissal. And we'll call this concluded today. Father, I thank you for your goodness and your mercy and your love that is abounded in our way today. Thank you, God, for an opportunity to be in your house to worship you. Thank you for our dedicated time together, oh God. Now we ask that for the remainder of the day, that you allow your Son, S-O-N and S-U-N, to shine upon us. Let us have good time with our families, even when we're sheltered in place. Give us traveling mercies for my wife and I this week, God. I know that you will. You're already going before us and watching over that situation. You're more than able. Thank you, God, for faithful people that continue to honor you in their giving, of their finance, and of themselves. Thank you, Lord, for your hand of provision and protection upon all of us. Continue to keep us bound together with cords of love that cannot be broken. And God will give you the praise for it in Jesus' name. All God's children said, amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. Thanks for joining us this morning.